when the sun comes out again, when the sun comes out.
In post-war Japan, a young 16-year-old girl was to emerge from the devastation to have a profound effect on the lives of many. This girl was soon to become one of the most influential women of 20th century Japan. Born into the wealthy Tokyo society of 1929, Sadako Kitahara was to enjoy a life of comfort, education and sophistication. But by the age of 16, her life was about to change forever. Under the leadership of the militarists, Japan was to engage in warfare that was soon to bring the nation to its knees. Convinced that the Americans were about to invade their land, adulterate the Japanese race, destroy the purity of its proud heritage, Satoko's father, Professor Kitahara, accepted a post in the Homeland Defense. Satoko herself prepared to defend her beloved motherland as well as all young women could. She also took up work in the Nakajima aeroplane factory. This was ultimately to prove for her fatal. As the United States bombed her hometown of Tokyo, Sadako was still very much influenced by the ancient code of Bushido, the way of the samurai, absolute loyalty to one's lord, precluding any thought of surrendering to the enemy. To be taken alive was a disgrace. The self-sacrificial ideals were cherished by Sadako. Wretchedly unhappy in learning how the militarists had misled the nation, disillusioned by the government's moral bankruptcy, Sadako set about finishing her education, and pessimism in the future of Japanese society was expressed by the image of the setting sun. Sadako finished her studies and graduated as a pharmacist, but continued to wonder what she would become in life. In her search for answers, she visited a university friend in Yokohama City. During one of their walks together in deep philosophic discussion, they chanced upon a Catholic church. Strikingly unusual to their Japanese eyes, their curiosity and sense of adventure forced them to enter this strange Gothic-like structure. Catching her eye in the corner of the church was a poor plaster statue of Our Lady of Lourdes. This gripped her whole attention. Sadako later wrote, "This was the first time I had seen a statue of the Blessed Mother. I gazed upon the statue, sensing the presence of a very attractive force. I had always experienced a vague but strong yearning for the pure. The very first time I remember glimpsing what seemed to be such a worthy object of this deep longing was of Miko, the shrine maiden, serving in Shinto sanctuaries." Returning to her hometown in Tokyo, Sadako spent the next restless weeks wondering about her exceptional experience. All her traditional beliefs were now being challenged in a very profound way. Despite her proud family background tracing its ancestry back 1,000 years to Shinto priesthood and Bushido warrior, Sadako was uncertain about what she would become in life. Anxious to explore her recent spiritual experience, she inquired into the foreigner's religion and found that Mary had led her to Christ. It was now that her health took a very terrible turn for the worse. During her wartime work back at the Nakajima aeroplane factory, Sadako avoided death when the factory was attacked by US bombers. But sadly, in the unhealthy atmosphere, she had already acquired the tuberculosis virus that was slowly destroying her lungs. With meticulous care, especially in her spiritual life, Sadako was prepared for baptism in the Catholic faith, but she desired to go further. She longed to enter the convent as a religious sister. And so it was, in great sorrow, when she found herself rejected because of her poor physical health. By now, Tokyo was being rebuilt, and a few years after the war ended, Sadako's parents moved to the fashionable suburb of Asakusa on the west bank of the Sumida River, and just a few hundred metres south of where the great temple of the Merciful Canon once stood. Little did she know that she was also living next to a Japanese nightmare and a most disturbing sight. On one fateful day in the comfortable suburb of Asakusa, just as the winter winds set in, Sadako went to find Zeno, the Catholic missionary who she saw heading down to the Sumida River. She ventured under the Tobu rail bridge and onto Sumida Park. There, opposite the cherry blossoms of Mukajima, was a shanty village built on the muddy riverbanks. Destitute and poor, isolated and rejected, victims of a dreadful war, these wretched souls scratched out a meagre existence by collecting rubbish for recycling. For her, this newly discovered community was both repulsive and yet attractive. The missionary Zeno had led Sadako from luxury to poverty and had lit a fire in her that would never go out. Could this really be Tokyo, she thought, the capital of Japan, where thousands lived so close to her own luxurious home, in subways and graveyards and even on muddy riverbanks? It was beyond her comprehension. The community she had just discovered was known as Antstown, whose boss, Azawa, along with the missionary Zeno, wanted her to teach the children a Christmas play. She welcomed them into her own home to do so, and she fast became their teacher. Despite dark shadows of tuberculosis increasing over her lungs, Sadako found herself drawn to the needs of the children, taking them on excursion away from their normal miserable surroundings, improving their basic education, looking after their hygiene needs, and teaching them the value of prayer. Daily, Sadako would visit Antstown in her brightly coloured kimono to work for the benefit of all. But she was to be deeply challenged by Turu Matsi, a non-believer and town leader who despised pretentious Christians, pointed out that if she was genuine, she would give up everything, become a rag picker, and live in poverty in order to truly follow her Christ. Even with her health in serious decline, the challenge was like an invitation to a life of pure sacrifice, one she had deeply desired from her youth. Mitsui's challenge resonated within Sadako's Japanese heart. Her spirituality came from the Shinto respect for tradition and love of virtue. All Japanese respect virtue, especially that of courage. Fashioned in the crucible of Shintoism, honor was given to the virtue of courage. There could be no greater courage than that displayed by the Shinto swordsman and Bushido warrior. These historic characters would put themselves to the sword rather than the disgrace of surrender. From this historic perspective came the desire to lay one's life down in defense of one's neighbor. So now, that same courage was being asked of Sadako, to lay down her own comfortable life and become a rag picker. Shintoism and Christianity had met. Sadako moved to Antstown in very poor health, isolating herself during times of high infection. Though suffering greatly from an ever-weakening physical condition, her presence was constantly in the community, helping, assisting, praying, and suffering. Gone was the brightly coloured kimono, present was the smile of the rag picker. Now known as Mary of Antstown, she helped the people recover their self-respect and dignity, helped the people repair their shanties, build a refectory, a bathroom, and a church. In her diary, she wrote, "I had always thought I was a great Christian because I condescended to dole out some free time helping Ant's children with their homework. To save us, God sent his only son to be one of us. He really became one of us. It hit me now. There was only one way to help those rag picker children. Become a rag picker like them." One winter's day, on a photo of Antstown, Sadako wrote the words, "Behold the handmaid of the Lord." And amidst her grave sufferings, Satoko had become just that. The smile of the beautiful rag picker remained as bright and wonderful